All right, welcome everyone who's here. Good to see you for another installment of Tuesday Tech Talks. I'm Clint Stevens, the arranger and provider sometimes of the great stuff that we're sharing. Today you're with me for Loom Pro. The slides, I put the link there in the chat, but they're at bit.ly/29 TTT slides. That's today's date. And Tech Talk Tuesday slides. So let's jump in here. So Loom Pro, I sent you a little blurb on it today, and just quick show of hands if you want to turn your camera on, or just say in the chat, whatever. How many of you guys are using something right now to record your screen to share with students, like either through Google Classroom or Canvas, or a thumbs up in your video? If you want to open up your mic. What are you using right now? Just because there's 100 tools. I'm not saying this is the best one. There's lots of them out there that work well, but just curious what everyone's using.
I'm recording on Zoom.
Okay. And that works great. Yep. You can just enter a meeting by yourself, hit the record button and share your screen and do whatever you need to do. You might be lacking a couple things, like there might not be any whiteboarding tools unless you open up a whiteboard. A little emphasis on where the mouse is, so your kids might not see where you're clicking or where you're going, which is a tool that Loom has. Anyone else using like Screencastify or?
I use Screencastify. This is Dory.
Dory, okay. And Jeremy said thumbs up on Screencastify. I think Millard's paying for that, isn't it? Don't you guys have a more than the 5-minute default time limit on that?
Yeah, I believe we are.
Yeah, and it's a great tool, and it works really well, and the recordings go straight into Google Drive, or you can send them to YouTube, and Screencastify used to be my former favorite, and I still like it. I still think it's a great tool, but we do not pay for it, unfortunately, so I'm stuck to that minute minimum. Yeah, just, I was looking for an L in there somehow, but I have another tool in my toolbox called ScreenFlow, and it is a Macintosh only. It's like $100 tool, and I can do loops. I can run circles around a lot of these inexpensive screen recording tools because it'll record my phone, it'll record my iPad, it'll record my desktop and my camera, and I can move things around and zoom in, zoom out. And that's not for everybody. I get to do this for my job, and I produce a whole lot of stuff. And so a little bit more powerful tool was useful to me, and I use it from time to time. But just for quick little things like to walk somebody through how to, problem solve something, or quickly show them how to do something, I've really turned to Loom, and I'll share with you why today. And if it's something you think you could benefit from, there is some good news about the availability of it for you. So we'll get to that. But isn't it frustrating when teachers hear, you spend 5 minutes describing exactly what to do, and then kids say, okay, so what are we supposed to do? And I was actually in that situation in a meeting, and it was admittedly, we're working on with the state to try to come up with a competency-based educational technology endorsement program. And so we've kind of whittled things down to some essential skills and things like that. And we had a meeting last week, and Rick Caseford at the state office kind of took about 10 minutes to kind of explain what had to happen. And then he broke us out into groups in Zoom. And then we all just kind of sat there and looked at him. All right, what are we supposed to do? So, we maybe could have used a little bit more explicit instruction, but anyway, Loom to the rescue. So it's a user-friendly screencasting tool. You can record your entire screen, anything that goes on your screen, and share it quickly and easily with students. Record your directions once, and so that if they have questions on what to do, they can go back and watch it. They can pause the recording after they've done parts A and B, and they need to know what to do for C, and so they're not relying on you or trying to remember, your steps. And we found in pandemic days and in these days of Zoom that students are much, much more likely to watch a short video on what has to be done and watch you describing it instead of trying to read lots and lots of text directions. And I'm guilty. I send long emails, even when I'm trying to just send you guys a quick reminder that the tech talk is coming up at 3:30 today. I always seem to write way too much. So that's a skill I need to work on. But hopefully these video little tutorials and things that we share are useful for you. And so aside from the obvious, you know, flipped classroom uses where you can use, you could record your instruction and have students watch that as their homework. And then when they get to school or when you have them with you, you can use that time for labs and activities and, you know, hands-on things. So that's, you know, Loom's a shoe-in for stuff like that. But you can also, again, create short how-to videos, model exemplars of anything from poetry annotation to lab safety procedures, or just send quick reminders home, adding links to viewers' direct videos to additional resources. That's one of the nice tools that Loom has that I haven't seen in a lot of other tools. It's called a call for action, which is kind of a buzz marketing term. But basically, at the end of the video, you can insert a link that says, okay, now that you've seen this, click this link and go here. And so if you're trying to, you know, set something up, explain it to your kids, just that one extra step, and, you know, where they don't have to go back to a Canvas or anything else, just what they need to do is right there. Hopefully that'll help with your flow and getting everything done. Here's the best part. Back, I think in April, they made this announcement, March, maybe April, when it was apparent that remote learning wasn't really going away anytime soon. Oh, gotta add somebody in. It's Chris, my counterpart, coming in late. I'll have to give her a hard time when her mic's on.
That's what I'm here for.
Hi, Chris.
Hey, I wanted
nice
to see what
you
I could
finally make it.
That's right. Wanted to see what I could learn from the master.
Just talking about how Loom back in April, May, whenever it was, announced that, hey, we can see that this is going to be something that teachers and students can use. So they opened up the reins and allowed teachers to create a pro account. They're calling it an education account now, but basically all their great teachers for free forever. And your students can sign up as well. They just need, and you just need to sign in and sign up with your school email address.
Yep, I love Loom.
Yeah, it's great. And Chris actually kind of started using it before me. And I said, I would watch your videos and say, wow, those are nice. How's she making that? So after you have an account, just verify it. And then they'll upgrade your account. So nothing extra special or whatever you need to do. So I will put this link in the chat as well, but it's just loom.com/education. There we go, is where you can sign up. Randy Butler says, I prefer Zoom, and that's okay. Zoom works, but there's a lot of things that Loom can do for you that aren't kind of cooked into Zoom, but Zoom's certainly simple and easy just to jump in, share your screen and start recording. So let's see, I'm gonna.
Let me jump in there real quick, because I use Loom almost every day. If a teacher calls and asks me, how do I do this? It takes me 2 minutes to make a Loom recording and send it to them rather than 10 minutes of typing something out. I think it's great for sharing videos to show your students how to do something.
I agree. Okay, so that link, loom.com/education, will take you to the Loom for Education page. The first step is to click this Get Loom for Free, just sign in with your school account, and then come back and go to this Verify Your Education account. And basically, you're just sending that same email address in, your millerk12.org or whatever, into them. They'll verify that it's an educational domain, and then they'll upgrade your account within a day or two. And again, so get started for free, get verified, and here's what you get for free. You don't get a cap on how many videos. You can record up to 45 minutes in length. Please promise me right now, hold up your hand and say, I will never record a 45 minute video to give to my kids. Okay, thank you. That's way too long. A good rule of thumb is about a minute per grade level is about as far of an attention span as you can rely on. You know, fifth grade, maybe a 5 minute video, you know, secondary kids, 10, 15 minutes at the very, very, very top. You can have only one creator on the account, but unlimited viewers. You get a personal library. You can share your videos. I haven't looked at the teams and that kind of stuff yet. They actually have a new thing called Workspace. Mostly businesses use Loom to kind of do these little tutorials and things like that, but they're opening up to educators for free. And you do get a nice little place where you can go back and search for the videos that you've already created. So instead of recreating something that you do over, you know, a few times a month or a term or whatever, record it once, go back and find it, and you know, send it off again. You can record in HD, you can record your screen and your camera, or just your camera. You get some drawing tools and mouse emphasis. So it'll kind of make your mouse a little bigger. And when you click, it'll put a little circle around it just to kind of draw attention, which can help out when you're doing tutorials and things like that. You can choose to record just a tab or a window, or your entire screen. It'll record system audio. And what that means is if they're recording a video showing on your screen, it will include that sound in with the recording. The call to action, I kind of made a little, told you what that is. That's a little link you can put in at the end to send people to the site you want them to go to. These are kind of fun, these emoji reactions throughout the video. So if, you know, if something cool happens, or if you need to want to speed up, slow down, whatever else, you can click on these little emojis as the video goes on. You can see that. Viewer insights. Have you ever wondered if a student has actually watched your video? Loom will actually tell you if and when somebody watches your recordings. If you just send it out as a, you can share it with specific people and it'll tell you who watched it. If you just send the links out like in an email, if they don't have to log into Loom to see it, then you won't know who watched it. But at least you do get that. You can go back and look and see, you know, how many times a video was viewed or anything like that. And then another nice thing, password protect videos. If you're showing, you know, sensitive information, or you don't have releases for your students, things like that, you can put a password on them and avoid some problems that way. And just continuing on this page, there is a desktop app that you can launch from your, it'll live in your little toolbar. And so you can record whatever you want. There's a great Chrome extension. I use both. There's also an iPhone and iPad app. And let me just throw those links in here into the chat for you in case you would like them. And let's see, back to the presentation. Nope, just kidding. Back to Loom for Education. And then if you keep going down, there's little quick tips on how to record your video, how to share, some keys for success, but I'll demo it for you. And I made sure this would work, make sure I can actually use a camera to record while I'm using a camera for a meeting to record. So let's see, I'm gonna stop this share and I'm just gonna share my entire screen this time. Basic. Any questions before I dive into Loom any deeper? Okay. All right, so let me just come back to this presentation. You guys see my whole screen, thumbs up? Okay. All right, so I'm gonna actually use, so there, I do have the toolbar. It lives right there in your Chrome toolbar. And you can choose to record the full desktop or the current tab you're in. And then you can choose a microphone and camera. If you have those, this little wiggly line there is showing me that Loom is hearing my voice. Down here in the bottom right-hand corner, I can choose what size my image is. So if you wanna start with, you know, a big image to introduce what you're gonna say and then knock it down to a smaller one, or if it needs to be in a different corner, you can move that video screen around. You also have some controls right there to cancel, pause, start recording. It gives you a little timer on how long you've been going. And if you don't want to see the menu, you can turn that on or off as well. But I'm not going to record from the tab. And I don't like to always record the full desktop because I have a giant screen. And if you're on a Chromebook on a tiny screen, my giant stuff that looks right to me looks teeny to a student maybe. So I like to use the desktop version, and I don't know if you can see, it looks like a little sunburst up here at the top. Are you seeing that little window drop down? Kathleen, yes, okay, cool. So from here, I can choose to record video or a screenshot. I haven't checked into that, but this option, full screen window. So I can choose a window. So if I have a bunch of tabs open, I can choose which window I want to record, and I can switch between the tabs and it'll resize, you know, to the right one for me. So I'll choose that window, and then it actually starts the countdown timer for me. Actually, no, I actually hit the button to start the recording when I'm ready to go, get the camera size that I want. I'll start off big to introduce it. And then I do have some extra tools down here while I use the desktop version. So I'll start recording. Counts me down. Hey, everybody. Just giving a quick walkthrough of Loom Pro for Teachers and the tools that are available for that. I click on that. That makes my camera full screen. I didn't demo this before I actually tried it. So I'm learning as we go. And I don't know where that button went now. There we go. Let's see. Can I go back? Nope, I don't want to do that. Resume. If I hit escape, does that do it? Chris, do you know how to get me out of this?
I didn't.
Oh, there it is. There it is. Yeah. There it is.
What did you do? I didn't hear that part.
So it looks like a little full screen icon, maybe.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And so it made my window my video the size of the full window.
The desktop.
There. Yeah. That one, I can switch between my camera. If I'm feeling shy today and I want to switch between my profile and my camera, I can do that.
Having a bad hair day.
That's right. And then the gift, I don't know what this is either. I didn't test this out before I started. Oh, I can add a frame. Very nice. So let's see, I can put in something for Valentine's Day. Isn't that cute? So I can engage my middle school kids here, my elementary kids. Anyway, but as I click, you can see that there's a little bloop right there. If I want to annotate, I've got some annotation tools here, so I can pick an orange and I can, you know, Loom and verification, and you're going to click on this link right here. Hard to draw with a mouse. I'll say done. So I get some annotation tools, and this is something you can't do with Zoom, is to have your video and yourself. Actually, no, Zoom does do a little thumbnail over there on the right, but you don't get the mouse thing. You don't get the annotation. And then when I'm done, I just hit the stop button, and it'll open up my Loom preview window. It automatically tries to name what I did. So I'll just call this a Loom demo. I can rename those quickly. Lots of different options here. This is the one I really like. I can choose what speed to watch back my preview or to watch any other videos, because it seems like I can't sit through a regular speed video anymore. So I could make myself 1.5 and I'll try that.
No sound.
Oh, I didn't bring in my sound. I can hear it. So sorry, it's not playing through, but it recorded it. And then if I, you know, want to scrub through it, make sure, you know, what I'm showing came through. There's switching that. There's putting the frame around my photo, the annotations, things like that. So within each video, I've got some preferences. If I want to allow comments, if I want to allow email notifications, if there's comments, if I want to turn on or off the emoji reactions, allow people to download the video, show analytics, things like that. There's some different settings you can make there. Trim the video. So if there's bits that you don't want in there, you can cut those out. Here's that call to action. So if I wanted you to, excuse me, put in a URL like https://sedckt12.org, something like that. And then, oops, wrong one. That is text. Cut that, paste that there. SEDC homepage. Whatever, if there's an assignment you want to send them off to, or just did a demonstration on Utah's online library, right, Chris, and you want to make sure they get there, put that link right at the end. And then as soon as the video's over, there's a button there that they click on and they can go to. Save that call to action. And it's up here all the time as well as you read. The sharing options are vast. So I can just send a link, a linked GIF, which means it'll put just like little, like a screen every second or so. So I'll give like a little preview of it. Embed, this is your friend if you're using Canvas. The embed code, you don't need to, it doesn't even show you what the code is. Good.
That makes it easy.
Yeah, you don't have to know what all this stuff is. This intimidates a lot of people. But all you need to know is that if I copy the code and I go to Canvas, do I have a Canvas tab open? I can do that real quick. Datastructure.com. Oh, never mind. There's a little cloud button, right, in the new Canvas editor that allow me to paste in embed code, and I can have my video just right inside of Canvas there for me. And Twitter, Facebook, Gmail, send it off to people. Share your video, make sure it's public or not. There's even some dots here. Archive, delete if you totally messed it up and you want to get rid of it. Invite people to edit it, rename it, share it, star it, whatever. So lots of features. If I had any comments, they would show up down below. But then...
Did you see that new? I haven't tried it yet. I just saw that pop up yesterday, that leave feedback. So that would be like for a student could leave feedback at a certain point. So if you showed a video and wanted the kids to say something at a certain point, is that how that would work?
Yeah, I'll just drop a comment in at whatever time.
Yeah, that's cool.
That's there. I'm going to show you at 128. Cool. That is nice. And so those are all the different options I've got within those that Loom recording. And then if I click over here on my personal library, I can go and see all the videos that I've ever created. I can see how many people have viewed them if I click into one. So like, let's see, publishing a Google site. I've had 4 viewers of that and nobody's made any comments, but you know, if I need to share it again or copy the video link, it's right there for me. So haven't dug into the team libraries and those other things, and we're getting close to the end. So I'm gonna
go back to the personal real quick. I want to share one of my just favorite things.
Okay,
making a folder. So if you do a new folder, and like especially for teachers, if you have to reteach kids same thing over and over, I have folders like one for Koha, one for Sora.
All right, where do I do that?
Right there up at the new folder, on the right. And then you can organize them, because otherwise you're going to end up like 100 videos all at once. And especially if you're not good at naming them, but you make the folder and then you can go look for that folder and say, oh, okay, that's where all my Canvas tutorials are, or my how to log into this or how to do that. Yep. And it really helps keep you organized. After I got about 100 videos, I realized I had to do that.
And then you can just share the link to the folder.
Mm-hmm.
And folks can just go and view all of those. So kind of like a playlist in YouTube.
But renaming them is important if you want to reuse them.
Very good. Thanks, Chris. Mm-hmm. And see, on iOS app, Chris says. Okay. So I'll stop my share. Any other comments, questions, things you want to find out or know? I do have a slide. Let's see, I do have a couple more slides here. It is COPPA, FERPA, and GDPR compliant. I've got a link there, and I can drop the link to that. Go ahead.
Does that mean kids can sign up for it? I had a question about that, and it didn't look like if they were under 13, they couldn't. And it's not on the state DP data privacy thing.
Okay. Probably yes, But you know, it's something that you could send out a something for your parents to approve.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
And then so there's the role form is in there. I'll drop in the link to the, that link didn't copy through. There we go. So here's the privacy. That's in the chat too. So they are, compliant. That whole 13 thing is they don't make anyone sign or they can't go out and have people under 13 agree to the user agreement and tie it to them. So that's why that 13-year cap is there for everybody. So let's see, the demo, we looked at the dashboard, talked about verifying your account, sharing embedding, password protect, video preference. I didn't show you where to password protect a video. And that, I'll just click on this one quickly.
While you're bringing that up, let me add one thing I kind of learned. early on, you want to use the app to be able to get those tools that Clint showed on the sidebar. So then you kind of go from the app. If you use the extension, you don't have that annotation tools and those things. Does that make sense?
Yep. Yeah. I talked about the app and the extension before you jumped in.
Alrighty.
It's good to bring that back up. So you can set a password on there, the call to action we talked about, renaming and trimming videos. So loom.com/education to get your account signed up for and verified for the free version. We've got 3 minutes left for any questions. Open up your, let's see, I'll stop my screen share. I believe I'm still doing that.
You're not sharing.
Ah, okay. Then my showing you where the password was didn't do much help, did it? Okay. Everyone got the role that needs it. Cool. You're welcome, Christine. Thanks for coming. Any other questions about anything else? Any media questions? Next week is Chris. And Chris, do you want to tell him what you're going to be talking about next week? It's my birthday, so I'm taking the day off next week.
And am I doing Canvas or?
It's Canvas next week.
Okay.
Yeah.
I know I got two coming up. Yeah, we're going to talk about Canvas. I know we've talked a lot about Canvas before, but everything has kind of been the how-tos of Canvas. And now we're going to go a little bit deeper and talk about more of those little tips and tricks. We did a little bit a couple weeks ago, but some of those things that just want to make your life easier. What can Canvas do? There's some new features that have come out. We'll talk more about analytics and some more tools that Clint and I, we just watched a C-Forum, a Canvas thing Friday. And I learned some new things that might be helpful to teachers to make things a little bit easier for you. So we'll be sharing some of those things. It'll be rapid pace like before. We'll show kind of some things, but we'll have links and instructions and time to talk about it.
Very good. Thank you, Chris. And then the next week after that is NEPRIS. And Chris will lead that, but I'll be here to facilitate that for it.
Yeah. And that I just, love NEPRIS.
Just real quick on what it is.
So NEPRIS is, if you've done virtual field trips kind of thing, NEPRIS is like that, but it's actually going out and finding industry professionals from all different industries. You could talk to robotics people. I talked to a spacecraft engineer. You can talk to all sorts of people and they'll have a conversation with your kids, but you can also have what's called industry chat. So if you've got students and want to explore careers and you want to look at, say, what's it like to be a chef, you know, they can watch videos of chefs and talk what that job is like. They could connect with the chef and ask questions live. So any job industry is represented in there. And so it really gives kids an opportunity, especially our rural kids, to explore a lot of different job opportunities and career choices.
Perfect. So that's coming up in 2 weeks. The archive will be there, SEDC TTT archive. Appreciate you being here. Thanks for all you do. We appreciate all your hard works and your efforts and all you've been doing for kids this year. It's Herculean and you don't get thanked enough. So thank you. We appreciate everything. And if you have questions about this or anything else, just reach out. Let us know how we can help. We're always here.
Anything you need, we're here for you.
Thanks, Whitney. Appreciate the happy birthday. It is my birthday month. We celebrate February. Yeah.
It's not just one day.
So you can say happy birthday anytime. It works. All right. I'll stop the recording.